99.73% of Austrians voted on the 13th of March 1938 that they want to join Germany, right? Well, this is only the partial truth, as there is more to that. In reality, the Austrian Chancellor, Kurt Schuschnigg, called for a referendum to happen, but due to an ultimatum by the Germans, he was forced to resign 2 days before the referendum. After that, Arthur Sesinquat became Chancellor and allowed the Germans to walk in and trick the referendum. So, what if he changed that and Kurt Schuschnigg didn't resign? Historically, his resignation was because, quote, to avoid the shedding of fraternal blood. In addition, something that I bet you didn't know is that originally, the Austrian painter and leader of the Ultranationalist Party ruling the German Reich planned to turn Austria into a client state ruled by Sesinquat, not to directly annex it. This changed when the German officers, the Wehrmacht and even the Führer himself visited Austria after the resignation of Kurt Schuschnigg. The Germans were greeted by flowers, cheering crowds and even ultra-nationalist German flags. This enthusiasm displayed towards the Germans surprised everybody, as most people had believed that most of Austrians opposed the Anschluss. This convinced the German Führer of the opposite, so he decided to directly annex Austria. The reality of the situation was that it was very delicate and something could have very well happened. For example, a day before the referendum on the 12th of March 1938, the 8th Army illegally crossed the border into Austria. The invading forces were poorly organized and there was almost no coordination between the separate units. Had they met resistance, they would have crumbled. Resistance, however, never came, as the Austrian government had ordered the Austrian police force and army not to resist. I hope that you have learned something new about the Anschluss and that the situation could have really gone different. To start off, if there was resistance, Austria wouldn't be directly annexed, which would have several implications. In addition, if the Munich Conference still takes place, I don't think that France and Britain would be so willing to give the Germans the Sudetenland. Let me tell you how the Second World War would change had Austria simply resisted. Let me tell you a bit more about the Austrian nation before the German annexation. You may not know it, but after the Great War, the Austrian part of Austria-Hungary was kind of screwed. Their territory was reduced just as much as the Hungarians, but for some reason we only say that Hungary and Germany were harshly punished. Austria wanted to retain the Sudetenland, as there were German speakers, and if Woodrow Wilson's plan of self-determination was completely followed through, the borders of Austria-Hungary may be really different. The Austrians said that it's unfair for every nation to get the right to self-determination except them. After the war, Austria was in shambles, as their industry was now in independent Czechoslovakia, and their food supply was in independent Hungary. Poverty skyrocketed in Austria and many wanted to join Germany as early as 1919. This trend would continue and until the end of the Second World War, a large portion of the Austrian population would be radicalized and vote for pro-unification political parties. Austria even had a 4-day civil war, where the Fatherland Front came out on top. They abolished the First Austrian Republic and created the Federal State of Austria. What you need to know is that Austria became an ultra-nationalist state, similar to that of Germany and Italy. The Austrian government, however, was very much pro-independence, and although they had a lot of similarities with the Germans, they refused to join them. Many people think that the German Führer first expanded into the Saarland via a referendum, then he remilitarized the Rhineland, and only then did he set his sights on the Austrian nation. This is absolutely not true. This guy, the guy who failed art school, came to power in Germany in 1933, and one of the first things he tried to do was a coup in Austria in 1934. I made a whole video about what if the Anschluss happened 40 years earlier. I'll remind you to check it out after this video has ended. The event was called the July Push, and the goal was for Germany to put Anton Rintelen of the Christian Social Party in charge of Austria, which was a pro-unification party with Germany. The party did have around 35% of the vote, so they were among the largest in Austria. Engelbert Dollfuss, the Austrian Chancellor at the time, was killed in this coup. He was succeeded by Kurt Schuschnigg. In the 5th of November 1937, the German Führer called for a meeting with many government officials and expressed his concern that due to constant rearmament, the German economy is starting to fail. They agreed that rather to do economic reforms that would improve the economic situation, they should just invade Austria and take the Sudetenland, where they can seize their treasuries. The Jews actually contributed a lot to the German economy at the time, just not voluntarily. They were raided and their jewelry and precious artworks were stolen, funding the German economy for a while. Fast forwarding to the events of 1938, many of you I bet don't know that the German Führer and Kurt Schuschnigg met exactly 1 month before the German annexation. This happened on the 12th of February 1938, in the city of Berchtesgaden, which is 30 kilometers or 19 miles from the Austrian border. They met in order to discuss the Austrian crisis, and Kurt Schuschnigg tried his best to preserve the independence of his country. They agreed that the Austrian government would feature politicians loyal to the German Führer and his ideology. The key appointment was that of Arthur Seyss-Inquart as Minister of Public Security, who gained complete control over the police. As I said, he was loyal to the German Führer, not the Austrian Chancellor, so what could go wrong? Well, we'll find out later, but for now, don't think about what happened. The German Führer agreed to respect the treaty between Germany and Austria signed on the 11th of July 1936. He also publicly said that he supports Austria's national sovereignty. Not even a month after the German Führer said that he wouldn't invade, he actually did. So, what if Kurt Schuschnigg simply reminded the German Führer about his promises because he clearly had forgotten? Then I assume the Wehrmacht would simply pull back off Austria and we would all live a happy and prosperous life, avoiding the Second World War, right? On a serious note, let me be clear, this video is not about Austria fighting back and winning. It's about them simply fighting back and most likely getting crushed in a week, maybe even two if they're lucky. Here in the alternate history part, we have several options to work with. One really popular option is for Engelbert Dollfuss to not get assassinated during the July push. This is possible to happen and he would realistically fight against the Germans, unlike Kurt Schuschnigg. This is because, as I said in the beginning of the video, Schuschnigg called for a referendum, which aimed to show the world that the Austrian people wanted to be independent. This failed as Germany invaded, because they feared that they might lose the referendum, so they pushed the Austrians to vote for the pro-unification option. The referendum was one simple question, which was supposed to be answered by yes or no. Here is the question. Are you for a free, German, independent and social, Christian and united Austria? For peace and work? For the equality of all of those who affirm themselves, for the people and the fatherland. Now, I don't know about you, but to me this doesn't sound like, yo, you cool with Germany annexing Austria, right? This I bet was on purpose and part of the German Führer's master plan. I want to give credit to Kurt Schuschnigg, as he only resigned when the situation was hopeless and war was imminent. In the long run, it turned out to be the wrong choice, as Germany just kept demanding more and more, up until they started a world war. Had Kurt Schuschnigg resisted, with the power of hindsight, the Munich conference would look really different, and France and Britain would be more wary of the German expansion. This is because we know the future, but Kurt Schuschnigg didn't. Before the Germans invaded and tricked the vote, Schuschnigg allowed the communists and the socialists to exist, and they would join his government and resist the annexation attempts, but even that failed. Engelbert Dollfuss would for sure fight to protect his people, but he would get defeated. This is one option I am suggesting. The other is for Kurt Schuschnigg to deny the German demands to give positions of power in Austria to pro-unification politicians and allies of the German Führer. Since these demands were exactly a month before Germany invaded, I want to use that as the point of divergence, as it makes everything more simple. If Engelbert Dollfuss wasn't assassinated, much could have been changed in the 4 years leading up to the Austrian crisis. I cannot predict what would happen in these 4 years, unlike the scenario in which Schuschnigg doesn't comply with the German demands, which would be easier to predict. So, Kurt Schuschnigg would refuse. Now what? Well, I assume that the German Chancellor is just going to give up and try another year. Wait, what? He just attacked Austria. Who would have predicted that? Salzburg is a major city and is one on the German border, so it would fall easily, but I assume that the Austrian police would try their best to resist that. Again, let me remind you that when Germany historically entered Austria, since Arthur Seyss-Inquart was Minister of Public Security, he controlled the police, so he ordered them not to resist. This time, Kurt Schuschnigg wouldn't agree to these demands, and Arthur Seyss-Inquart would never have control over the police, hence why they would resist. The Austrian city of Linz would also quickly fall, but the other Austrian major cities, this being Vienna, Graz, Klagenfurt am Würtelsee, Villach and Innsbruck, would remain under control of Schuschnigg. This is how the frontline I think would look like after the first day of war. While the Germans have captured key cities, they just drove to them and the countryside is yet to be pacified. I don't rule out the possibility of Schuschnigg being assassinated. After all, in Austria around 40% of the votes were for political parties who demanded pro-unification. John Gunther in his book Inside Europe said this. By the end of 1933, Austrian public opinion about German annexation was at least 60% against. In the same book, he claimed that a year prior in 1932, Austria was probably 80% pro-Anschluss. You can see that the support of Anschluss has been declining, after all Austria became a dictatorship in 1934, and all parties were banned, so we don't have the numbers after that. Since the Wehrmacht was poorly organized and didn't expect to meet resistance, they would crumble. I don't rule out the possibility of Austria retaking Linz, but the good news would stop there. After the initial blunder of the Germans, they would go all in against Austria. I would predict that after this has happened, Vienna would fall in around a week. While Austria itself is mountainous, it's only for the western part. You can see from this map, from Salzburg to Linz, the road to Vienna is pretty much open. Austria will not be able to use their terrain advantage, so I assume all the flatlands would fall easily. If Schuschnigg is shot dead, which is a real possibility, Austria may agree to put Arthur Sessinquat as Chancellor and regain their lands. This operation by Germany would take only a week, so no country would be able to intervene in this time. This I feel is the most likely option, but just because it's the most likely, it doesn't necessarily mean that it's the most realistic. For example, the rise of the Austrian painter, famous for his mustache, was far from guaranteed. I acknowledge the fact that if he didn't rise to power, somebody from the ultra-nationalist party, like Heinrich Himmler, would rise to power instead. But let me tell you what I mean. The future German Führer participated in the First World War, so he could have been shot there. A British soldier actually came close to doing that, but he spared a man. On the 27th of April 1919, 30,000 soldiers of the Freikorps crossed into Bavaria to restore order and put down the Bavarian Commune. The communist government was supposed to execute 100 prisoners, among which was the Austrian painter. 20 were murdered, but the killing was stopped before the Austrian painter and Rudolf Hess were executed. Then we all know that the beer hall push, after which the Austrian painter was supposed to serve 5 years in prison, but was released early. The Austrian painter was also broke before he started selling his book, so him dying of poverty is a real possibility. Now, just look at how much could have gone wrong, and yet, it all went perfectly and he became the German Führer. The same situation is for Napoleon Bonaparte's rise to power, the assassination of Franz Ferdinand and the rise of power of Stalin. All of these candidates were really unlikely to happen, but it did, so it's realistic. I want to say that less likely doesn't mean less realistic. I want to ask you to rate the realism of this video from 1 to 10 so far, with 1 being the least realistic and 10 being the most realistic. I'm trying to improve my rating. Now, going back to the German invasion. Either the Austrians allow Arthur Sessinquat to become Chancellor, which would restore Austria's borders, but they would become a German client state. Another option is for them to keep fighting, making it really costly for the Germans, which would for sure prevent or delay massively the Sudetenland crisis. I say prevent because the Allies used the appeasement strategy to buy time. If the Germans are preoccupied with Austria for a long time, then the Allies can simply defend Czechoslovakia instead of Poland. This means no Molotov-Ribbentrop pact between Germany and the Soviet Union. So the world is drastically altered, with Austria just continuing to fight. This could have very well prevented all of these countries highlighted to be capitulated. Now that Austria has put some pressure on the Germans, I think that France and Britain would cease their policy of appeasement. This is because they don't need so much time, and they would realize that the German army and high command is not as strong as they had initially thought. This is why, when the Sudetenland crisis happens, I don't think that France and Britain would just let Germany have it. This is because Czechoslovakia could in theory resist the Germans and have a very good chance at defending themselves alone. If France and Britain were to join, this would tip the scales, so there is no point for appeasement anymore. The German Führer would try to convince the world that Sudetenland is his last demand, but nobody would buy it. The Sudetenland crisis would be attempted to be resolved diplomatically. An agreement that would appease the German Führer's justification would be reached. The German Führer justified that he wanted the Germans in Czechoslovakia to be equal to the Czechs and the Slovaks. For comparison, this is not only the Germans, but also the Poles, Hungarians and Ruthenians had lacking representation in the nation of Czechs and Slovaks, Czechoslovakia. This is why I suggest the country renames itself to the Central European Federation, which would make the Germans in the country equal to the Czechs or the Slovaks. If the German Führer still decides that he wants to gain the Sudetenland, then the world would know that he wants to conquer land, and not to benefit the German people. This is why if the German Führer continues to claim the Sudetenland, it's very possible for a coalition to form against him. Poland can even join and see some parts of East Prussia and Danzig, which was an independent port city at the time. The Italians, although they had signed the Pact of Steel, wouldn't intervene to save the Germans. Let us not forget that Italy joined the Second World War only when France was weeks from capitulating. The Italian Duce wasn't ready for a war and didn't want to risk it. Him intervening in this scenario would be crazy and very much out of character. At most, he would occupy Albania while the rest of the continent is busy. A similar outcome happened in a book I wrote about what if Kaiser Wilhelm III fled to Germany, East Africa and established a government in exile. Then he would fight in Austria against ultra-nationalist Germany and if he were to win, he would take the throne of Germany. If you're interested, I suggest you check the description and the pinned comment, where you can purchase this book. You can either buy an ebook or purchase the physical copy. Going back to the video, Germany would be capitulated easily. There is no denying that. The good news is that Germans would have never built a Holocaust. Only the Mauthausen concentration camp near Linz in Austria could be built. This was one of the most populated concentration and forced labor camp. So when I say only, I don't mean like it's a small number, it's quite the opposite. It would be just far less devastating than what the ultra-nationalist Germans had done to the continent of Europe. In the peace treaty, a strong German government is needed, which shouldn't lose too much land. If Germany were punished too badly, they might turn communist. So Poland would again be destroyed on both sides. The Poles would take the lands I just mentioned, and the French would annex the Saarland. These are the only territorial changes. It's possible that Germany becomes a constitutional monarchy, since the Weimar Republic and the democracy failed, as well as the ultra-nationalists. There is no other option between monarchy and communism. Since the Allies didn't want a communist Germany, constitutional monarchy is the answer. Maybe the House of Hohenzollern returns with Wilhelm III becoming the German Emperor. Another alternative is that the British put a monarch from their house, which would be even better. I cannot tell you for certain, but I would guess that Austria would have a vote on whether they should join Germany, remain independent, or join the Central European Federation. I would assume that they would choose the last option, since independence clearly didn't work out for them, and they still didn't know what the new German state would look like. If not, I promise to show you this video I made regarding what if Germany annexed Austria in 1934, so 4 years earlier. Check it out if this topic interests you. I hope to see you there.